Today's scripture reading is from Genesis chapter 8, verse 1 to 9, verse 7. Chapter 8. But God remembered Noah and all the beasts and all the livestock that were with him in the ark. And God made a wind blow over the earth, and the waters subsided. The fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed. The rain from the heavens was restrained, and the waters receded from the earth continually. At the end of 150 days, the waters had abated. And in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. And the waters continued to abate until the 10th month. In the 10th month, on the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains were seen. At the end of 40 days, Noah opened the window of the ark that he had made and sent forth a raven. It went to and fro until the waters were dried up from the earth. Then he sent forth a dove from him to see if the waters had subsided from the face of the ground. But the dove found no place to set her foot, and she returned to him to the ark, for the waters were still on the face of the whole earth. So he put out his hand and took her and brought her into the ark with him. He waited another 7 days, and again he sent forth the dove out of the ark. And the dove came back to him in the evening, and behold, in her mouth was a freshly plucked olive leaf. So Noah knew that the waters had subsided from the earth. Then he waited another 7 days and sent forth the dove, and she did not return to him anymore. Verse 13, in the 601st year, in the first month and the first day of the month, the waters were dried off from the earth. And Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked, and behold, the face of the ground was dry. In the second month, on the 27th day of the month, the earth had dried out. Then God said to Noah, go out from the ark, you and your wife and your son and your son's wives with you. Bring out with you every living thing that is with you of all flesh, birds and animals and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, that they may swarm on the earth and be fruitful and multiply on the earth. So Noah went out and his sons and his wife and his son's wives with him, every beast, every creeping thing, and every bird, everything that moves on the earth went out by families from the ark. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of men. For the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I ever again strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. Chapter 9. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you green plants, I give you everything. But you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. And for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast, I will require it, and from man. From his fellow man, I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. And you, be fruitful and multiply. Increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Let's pray for the children who are going to for a CD class. Dear God, thank you for this day and for all children here to learn about you. Please help them to understand about your love and grow in their faith. Bless their teachers and guide them as they teach. And we pray that may this time bring everyone closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The message for today is, the title is, But God Remembered Noah. Pastor Vernon.
Well, a very good evening. The warmest of welcomes to you. If you're a visitor with us this evening, we haven't met. My name is Vernon. I'm one of the pastors here at Zion Bishan. It's a joy to have you with us as we continue our series of sermons in the book of Genesis. This Sunday is the third week, week number three of the four that we will spend in the Bible's account of Noah and the flood. We saw last week the arrival of the great flood that wiped out most of humanity and most of the species of living creatures on the face of the earth. We grappled with the extent, with the seriousness of this global event carried out by the grieving Creator God as He wiped out so much of His once good creation. Now, it might not surprise you that as someone with young kids in our household, I spend a lot of time thinking about things that stain. Things that stain our clothes, things that stain our sofas or beds or walls. You know, just the other morning, Ruth was saying to me that we should get some new covers for our sofa, because our current sofa fabric covers, well, they're beginning to show lots of stain marks. No points for guessing where those stain marks came from. So I said, we'll think about it. We put the covers in our Lazada cart. And literally, within that very hour, something happened with one of the kids, not saying which one, that caused Ruth to have to strip down all the entire sofa, strip all the covers off, and put them in the wash. Literally just a couple of minutes after we talked about getting new sofa covers. So yes, I think a lot about stains and what stains are the worst. Do you think about that? You ever think about that? What are some things that you especially think, you're especially careful with because you know how badly they stain clothes, sofas, beds? Do you have a list of things that you really watch out for? Red wine, maybe. Permanent ink. Coffee. How about curry? Or dried blood. Did you know that if you leave blood long enough to dry on fabric, the proteins in the blood, they dry and it becomes impossible to wash off because those proteins have basically permanently bound together to irreversibly stain fabric. Did you know that? What stains are so bad, so permanent, so widespread that you know the moment they get stained with this, it's better to just throw the thing away. Give up. Get a new piece of clothing, get a new sofa, get new covers. A stain that needs washing, that's one way to look at what we've been seeing so far in Genesis. You see, since Genesis 3, we've been introduced to the stain of sin entering this world. And we've seen that stain grow, get deeper and more widespread as we follow the generations of Adam and Eve. Listen again to God's assessment of mankind in Genesis 6. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with violence, and God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. Wickedness, evil, violence, those traits that we saw at the fall, they've grown. No longer is it just isolated to Adam and Eve, to Cain, or even the greater violence of his descendant, Lamech, but this corruption has multiplied and filled the earth. Isn't that the exact opposite of what God created mankind for? To fill the earth with goodness, with His image and His good rule. How would you rate this worldwide corruption if you were to view it as a stain? How bad would this global stain of sin be? I'm sure if the world in this state was something we owned, something we had dominion over, well, we'd well and truly be thinking about discarding it, wouldn't we? About throwing it all away and starting afresh, starting with something completely new. Well, we saw last week how God justly responded to this widespread stain of sin. He responded with this, the flood. The great washing of the world that destroyed the wicked and corrupt, destroyed almost all of mankind except for one family line, one righteous man who was saved from judgment, along with his family who were saved through him, the righteous man. We come today, friends, to the aftermath of God's worldwide washing of the stain of sin. And because it's so serious, we should pause now and pray for God's help as we look at what happens after the great washing. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, help us now to see what You want us to see as we learn from the flood, as we listen very carefully to what You say after the flood. Send Your Spirit now to give us understanding that our hearts might be as Yours, as we look at our world today. Help us through these words in Genesis to know and love Your Son Jesus more, that we might live for Him until the day of His coming. In His name we pray. Amen. Well, please open your Bibles with me to Genesis 8, if you haven't already. And as usual, there's an outline in your e-bulletins which will give you some very specific references that will help you make sense of this quite complex and difficult account. I see, what happens after 150 days of flood waters prevailing over the earth has been really personally quite challenging for me to process. And here's why it's been so difficult to think through. You see, is what happens after the flood ultimately supposed to be read, to be taken positively or negatively? Are we supposed to be positive, optimistic as we read this account? Or should the reader know that this is not quite good news? You know, of all the commentaries that I've read, they've been equally divided. Some are very upbeat, this is such a good thing. Some have been quite negative. Oh, don't you see how terrible this aftermath is? And so actually, some of our preaching team discussions as well, we've been back and forth. Is this a good or bad thing? The post-flood account. So my conclusion, which is a bit of a cop-out so far, is that the answer is both. We're supposed to be both optimistic and pessimistic at the same time about what happens after the flood. You know, what came to mind as I realized this is that we've been thinking our kids are about the age where we're thinking about roller coaster rides. Roller coaster rides, whether they're old enough to go on roller coaster rides, whether they'll enjoy it. So I realized, actually, this post-flood account, it's a bit of a roller coaster ride. This passage has both ups and downs, just like a roller coaster. But just like a roller coaster, do you realize you need both the ups and the downs in a roller coaster ride for you to appreciate it? Think about it. How boring would a roller coaster ride be if there were no ups and downs? If it was just constant all the way, it'd be a pretty boring roller coaster ride. You wouldn't want to go on such a roller coaster ride, would you? You would never really appreciate the anticipation of the climb, and you certainly would never experience the gut-wrenching feel when you plunge down, if you didn't have both the ups and the downs. And so the way that I decided to cover our text this evening is to do three run-throughs of our passage. And I hope the symbols on your outlines will hopefully help you process and make sense of this as we go through the text three times. So come with me on our first read-through of the text, where we should see just how positive things are after the flood. The very first words of our passage today are from Genesis 8, verse 1. The very first words should immediately cause us to rejoice, given what the situation was before the flood. 8, verse 1. But God remembered. He remembered Noah and all the beasts and all the livestock that were with him in the ark. The significance of these first three words should not be missed. In the rest of Genesis, every time God remembers someone, it is a great source of hope. Whatever has happened in the flood, these three words tell us that God has not abandoned humanity. Even in his near wiping out of all living things, he has not given up. There is a remnant. There is still hope for mankind. God's plan for creation has not ended in wickedness and evil. There is more. Now, the rest of the Genesis 8 account, it shows us what the entire flood account from start to finish, which takes roughly about a year, 150 days of water prevailing, and another half a year or so until the waters abate to the point where the earth is dry. You know, some of the details of these accounts, they're not very easily interpreted, like the roles of ravens and doves and olive trees. So we won't quite get into that. But some of the key words that we spot here are used very, very deliberately to give us lots of hope, lots of optimism as what's happening after the flood. Well, look with me at the table in your outlines. These are some of the little details that I think make us think very positively of what happens after the flood. In Genesis 8, verse 1, where it says, the wind blew over the waters. Now, many of us know that the Hebrew word for wind, ruach, has a triple meaning. It means spirit, wind, or breath. So it reminds us of something in Genesis chapter 1, where the spirit hovered over the face of the waters. It's the exact same word in the Hebrew. If you knew Hebrew, you would think Genesis 1, verse 2. When the waters recede and abate and dry land appears, what does that remind you of in Genesis 1? Where it reminds you of 1 verse 9. On that day where God gathered the waters and the earth was formed. How about the living creatures being told in 8 verse 17, be fruitful and multiply? Well, that's an echo of day 5 of creation in chapter 1 verse 22. Where they're exactly the same process, right? The living creatures are told, be fruitful and multiply. And in 9 verse 1 and 7, where God repeatedly says, be fruitful and multiply, this time to men. After 9 verse 1, God blesses Noah in the same way that God blessed Adam and Eve in 1 verse 28 and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. There are lots of other little details, like 9 verse 3, God gives Noah and his family everything to eat, just as he gave every green plant and tree to Adam and Eve. See, all these little details, these words that are exactly used, are meant to point us back to the creation account. We should read this passage and understand that this massive global flood has been a reset. It's a giant reset button that God has done. He's bringing us back to before the fall. It's a second chance for all of creation. And not only is it a second chance, But you have now a righteous man, Noah. That's more than can be said for Adam in the first account. A righteous man who not only is righteous, but who has remembered all of what's come. You know, if you're giving a second chance at something, and you know all the mistakes that past generations have made, wouldn't you have a much better chance at doing well the second time, the second chance that you're given? So there's lots of hope. We should be hopeful and optimistic. I remember those first three words, and God remembers. You have a God here who is utterly committed to not leaving mankind to wickedness and evil, to doing something about it, to going through the trouble of pressing this giant reset button to fix, to wipe out wickedness and evil that had corrupted the earth. But our enthusiasm should be tempered and balanced somewhat by a second read-through. Well, let me make some observations, starting from 8, verse 20 and 21. What does Noah do after he exits the ark in 8, verse 20? Well, Noah built an altar to the Lord, and he took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird, and he offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelt the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground. Sounds good. Never again curse the ground because of man. Listen to this part quite clearly, carefully. For the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I ever again strike down every living creature as I have done. For the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Those of us who know the Genesis account well will know, again, Genesis chapter 6. Genesis 6 verse 5, where what does the Lord's assessment of mankind as he sees the wickedness? That every intention of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil continually. What has the flood changed? Well, apparently not a lot. Man's heart is still evil. After the greatest washing in the history of all creation, can you imagine how many billions and billions and billions of liters of water was involved in washing of the world in the flood? After all that washing, the answer is simply not enough. All that water was not enough to bring about the reset, the real reset that creation needs. It's external washing, isn't it? It's like if you have mold. Anybody said mold in their house before? If you spot mold on your house, you know what not to do? You don't take paint and just paint over it. That's an external washing. You need to get to the heart of the issue. You have to address what's growing underneath. And here, the evil is in man's heart. And we get hints of this in the rest of the passage. Listen again to some of the details that tell us this isn't quite the perfect reset to God's good creation in Genesis 1 and 2. In Genesis 9, verse 2 and 3, the fear of you, he says to Noah, the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. Now, if you're a meat lover here in this hall, don't get carried away. I know this sounds like good news to you. But it's not, is it? The fear of you, the dread of you shall be in every animal. That doesn't quite sound like the harmonious, unified creation, the good creation that happens in Genesis 1 and 2. Fear and dread between creation and man. He goes on in verse 4. But you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is its blood. And for your lifeblood I will require a reckoning. From every beast I will require it, and from man. From his fellow man, I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. God here is giving one of the very first few laws. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. Here's a question. When do you need a law? When do you need a law? You know, back in January 1992, Singapore passed quite an astounding law. Anybody know what it is? Some of you might not have been born. We passed the law making the sale of chewing gum illegal. Only country in the world to do it. The sale of chewing gum. Do you think the Singapore government passed this law just for the sake of it? Just to say, we're going to implement now and we're going to put this command, this law in place with penalties. Just because, you know. No, they did it because they wanted people to stop sticking chewing gum on the side of MRT trains and under chairs of public transport. They knew people would do it. We're doing it already, in fact. Think about the implication of God giving this law at this point. Why is there, if the flood worked and wiped away sin and brokenness, why would God need to give a law that says life for life, blood for blood? Unless he knew that Cain, the murderous intent, the evil that started with Cain, wasn't the last of it, that the flood didn't fix it. That Lamech's vengeance against brothers, against fellow mankind would continue. You see, that's quite depressing, isn't it? To see that God anticipates just how bad things are going to get. You can read this quite positively. You can read that God is intervening and stopping violence, but ultimately this still is a downward trend. It still means the big problem, the actual root of the problem, has not been fixed. And as we look at these three details, these warning signs, what's absent from this recreation account is actually equally telling. Remember what God says in the first creation account? At the end of every single day, and to wrap things up at the end of day six after he had finished creation, it is good. God saw it was good. And God saw it was very good. Do you notice there's not a hint of that here? Because it's not perfectly good. Well, the flood hasn't worked. It isn't quite the perfect reset that this world needs. The world's great washing, all that billions of liters of external washing, hasn't worked. Read through number three. Now, this is where reading the Old Testament is a bit tricky, because the way that we read it as 21st century Christians, we know the ultimate answer to what all of Scripture is pointing to. But even in the ups and downs of this passage, listen to what I would call hidden hope. Hidden hope. Well, firstly, two hints. Two hints that point to one main point. Two hints. Well, look at me at Noah's burnt offering. I'll read again very closely. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord. He took some of every clean animal, some of every clean bird, and he offered burnt offerings, very specific kind of offering. And when the Lord smelt the burnt offering coming and the pleasing aroma coming from it, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of men. Now, if you know the rest of Mosaic law, you'll know that in the book of Leviticus, which is the priestly handbook for the Levites, chapter 1 of the book of Leviticus says this. The Lord called Moses, spoke to him from the tent of meeting, saying, speak to the people of Israel, say to them, when any one of you brings an offering to the Lord, this is what you should do. If his offering is a burnt offering from the herd, Leviticus 1 verse 3, he shall offer a male without blemish. He shall bring that burnt offering to the tent of the meeting that he may be accepted before the Lord. He shall lay his hand on the head of the burnt offering. And what's the purpose of the burnt offering? It shall be accepted for him to make atonement for him. The priest shall offer all of it and burn it on the altar. It is a burnt offering, a food offering with a pleasing aroma to the Lord. Word for word, burnt offerings that are a pleasing aroma to the Lord that are made in Leviticus for atonement of sin. You know what another word for atonement is? Washing. For washing of sin. Well, here the hidden hope hint number one is that God is pleased by atoning sacrifice, sacrifice that requires blood. Hint number two, from 9 verse 4. Do you realize that 9 verse 4, as we read that law being given, whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made man in his own image. Do you realize here that God is telling you what his justice requires? His right judgment, which we heard about last week from Brother Daddy's sermon, his righteous judgment now requires blood for blood. What gives life? What appeases God's sense of justice? Blood. Two hints with one main point. Blood atonement offering is required for right relationship with God to please the Lord. And God's reckoning, blood reckoning, is required for God's righteous sense of judgment to be appeased. Now, I would say that this is a foreshadow, a hidden hope again. But we know where this leads to. What is the point of today's passage? Well, God hasn't given up on mankind. Trust in that. He hasn't thrown humanity and this creation away. In fact, later on in last week, we saw he will establish his covenant with Noah. But a covenant, how will this covenant work if even the great flood did not work? Our brothers and sisters, today the big lesson of what our God wants us to know is what doesn't work. External washing does not work. Now, this helps us understand exactly how serious the stain of sin is. If you realize what doesn't work, actually, humanly, what needs to be thrown away, what needs to be started completely new, which will give you great appreciation for any solution that does work. I've always said this, you need to realize how big and how deep the problem is before you realize how great our God's solution is. Do you realize that most of God's word, the Bible, is telling us about the problem? It's showing us what doesn't work, but it's giving us hidden hope, giving us patterns, helping us to know the characteristics of our God, that we might trust in him and trust in his commitment to cleansing, to washing our stain-filled world. Friends, let me drill a bit deeper into this big idea. Today, this evening, in the 21st century, how might you be tempted to think you can contribute to making this world a better place? What do you think really makes this world a better place? Improves this world? You know, in just a couple of weeks, our friends in America are going to go to the polls. If you listen to the campaigning, if you listen to the rhetoric, it's very apparent that they think the right person in the Oval Office will make America great again, will solve America's problems. The right people in power, the right social policies, the right immigration policies, is that what we think makes the world a better place? In our workplace, in our schools, what do we think really makes our world a better place? Doing good? Fighting for justice? Yes, definitely. Reflecting the desire of our good Creator God for this world to reflect his attitudes? Yes, but this passage, you see, so early in Scripture, is so important because it helps us think what doesn't work. It helps us to know what doesn't work. God is lovingly telling us that nothing we can change in our environment, nothing we can change externally, is going to solve the big problem of sin-stained hearts. Sin-stained hearts are the problem. And nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing, but a blood atonement reckoning will satisfy the great need of this world to be washed. Our friends, in just a few moments, we're going to sing our response song. Our response song, which is nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? What can make this creation how it should be? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Do you believe this? As we live in this world, awaiting the judgment that we've seen last week is coming, where is our confidence in making this world a better place, in making this world the place that it should be? Well, the flood account tells us nothing but the blood of Jesus. Why don't I give us a few moments to reflect on that before we stand together and sing. Let's pray together as we close. Our dearest Heavenly Father, give us our eyes to see, ears to hear, just how bad the stain of sin is as we look at our world today. Help us to know what doesn't work so that we run. We go all in on what does work, the blood of our Lord Jesus. Help us to live for your only solution. In his name and for his name's sake, we pray. Amen.